Sorry, question.
So does that mean that somebody who was super duper rich, say like Bill Gates, could buy up everything on the market and resell it way lower and actually completely destroy the whole system?
The question was, I think we've got the question was about whether someone who is super rich like Bill Gates could use their huge financial assets to basically destroy the market. In principle, you probably could do something like that. The best example, I mean, I don't know if you could do it to the world market, not, you know, $150 trillion, that might be a bit much. But the good example of that would be what George Soros did in 92 when he forced the Bank of England to pull sterling out of the exchange rate mechanism. And he did it simply by putting a big advert in the Financial Times saying, I'm betting that this won't hold its value, that the Bank of England won't be able to maintain the value of sterling. And because everybody assumed that Soros was a sharp operator, everyone started selling sterling, and sure enough, it was a self-fulfilling prophecy. So is it possible in principle? Yeah. Could you do it to the whole market all at once? Probably not. But you could put a big dent in it. So, you know, if you want to destroy the financial market, set up a giant hedge fund and trade like a lunatic. Okay. Oh, well, actually, you don't need to. The banks do it for you. So anyway, where does the media tie in with this? Well, there's a couple of ways that the media tie in. I mean, one, the system of coordination requires the interlinkage of all these exchanges around the world in real time. And it might look like that's a great idea. Everyone gets all the information as soon as it's available. In fact, you get it in real time. But there's a problem here as well. And the problem is this. Information is meant to make markets efficient. It's meant to, if everyone has all the information, people trade on companies or bonds or currencies or other securities, and they drive them to their correct price in line with fundamentals. If only. I haven't interviewed anyone in the financial markets that actually believes the markets are efficient. But in some ways it does work like that. Because the problem is that there's no advantage. If everyone's got all the information all the time, what can you trade off that's advantageous? Okay, you can be an insider trader, but people go to jail for that. And you might think it's rife. I don't think it's as rife as people suppose. I mean, most financial traders I talk to are actually pretty straight and conservative. You know, tut about these things. So I don't think that's a common thing. So where are you going to get your advantage from? How can you beat the market? You know, market theory actually says it's a random walk. Basically, you're guessing. So you know, who's running your who's running your KiwiSaver fund? You know, that'd be an interesting question. What are they actually doing? Are they doing anything more than throwing darts in the Wall Street Journal? Actually, they did an experiment with that. The dart thrower beats a financial expert. So you've got to be careful. Now let's go to John Keynes. And if you'll pardon my, well, I think this is a 1936 analogy, and it's a little bit sexist, but he says the financial markets are a bit like a beauty competition that he saw in a newspaper. And they put the various pictures of women in the newspaper, and the competition was you had to guess who the winner would be. And the winner was the one that most people guessed. So he says, so how do you win? And Keynes says, well, you don't win by picking the woman that you thought was prettiest. Okay? That's your subjective opinion. The way you win is by second-guessing what everybody else is going to guess. He said, that's how the financial markets work. And so if you guess that everyone else is going to trade in a particular direction, you can make money on that if you guess right. And so a lot of the valuable information is what you call meta-information. It's information about what information counts. And, you know, I don't know if any of you trade, or whether you're a day trader, or you've got a system for trading at home, good luck. Because you aren't privy to the circuits where that information is going to be made available. And it's not insider trading, it's the specialist knowledge of when and where the frameworks and the models that drive trading decisions are going to change. And what my research has suggested is that that's not what you're going to get as an ordinary, you know, mom-and-pop type investor. You can lose the shirt off your back if you're not careful. So the institutional investors have an advantage. But they don't always know when these things are going to work out. You know, the media may play a role here, particularly in times where the markets are changing, in amplifying expectations, in driving, you know, the collective opinion of markets towards particular directions of trade. You know, the work of Dick Bryan in Australia pointed out that one of the reasons that, that Australia wasn't affected by the Asian crisis was the fact that the media treated it very much as a separate issue. They just didn't think that this could affect Australia. And so in a sense, it was a positive, self-fulfilling prophecy. You know, the reason market traders in Australia didn't panic was because the broad sense was, well, now this is someone else's problem, it's not going to affect us. If all the media had been speculating that we're next and it's just a matter of time and it's all going to blow tomorrow, then it could have been a very different story. So markets can easily become irrational. I'll finish off in a moment. There's a very interesting economist that I think is worth looking at here, called Hyman Minsky. Has anyone come across Minsky? He's become quite popular in recent years. He was a contemporary of Milton Friedman, you know, sort of great neoliberal monetarist thinker, if that's not the right word. He's certainly, you know, the ideologue of New Right economics, and is very, very influential. Minsky was his contemporary. He argued that financial markets are intrinsically unstable. Yeah, and his financial instability hypothesis suggests that actually they're unstable in ways that you can't regulate out. Now, that was completely anathema to New Right neoliberal ideology that said that all the inefficiencies of markets came from pesky governments interfering or borrowing money to spend on useless things like welfare and pensions. You know, so it didn't fit the New Right analogy. Well, it turns out the guy was absolutely spot on, and his framework for explaining the crisis is probably the best model I've seen. Interestingly, the financial experts I've spoken to all knew about Minsky way before this, because they weren't interested in ideology, they were interested in how the markets actually worked. And Minsky pretty much was on the money. What he says is that and it goes back to the money supply. In periods of economic growth, market confidence gets high. Banks are quite happy to lend because they think, well, the economy is growing, you'll be able to pay us back. So money is cheap, people can borrow, and they invest in financial securities.
Can I try and find a solution to take us away?
Because they think they can get good returns on that. And that MM circuit that Marx talks about, the money-to-money circuit that he thinks is insane, can grow very, very quickly when people are borrowing money and investing heavily. So you get a bubble. But here's the thing. Minsky says it doesn't look like a bubble at the time. It's positive feedback. We borrowed, we invested, the market's growing, we're all happy. You know, everyone's confident. All the analysts are predicting the future well. The media go to the analysts and they say, oh yeah, it's a rosy future, it's all bullish, it's all going to be great. And of course it keeps on going like that. And he says very, very slowly and imperceptibly, you work towards what becomes effectively a Ponzi scheme, where you end up having to borrow more and more and more money to keep up with the interest levels. But as long as your expectations of market growth are there, that you don't realise that you're stepping further and further out onto thin ice, until once somebody defaults, you know, whether it's, you know, people who borrow too much for the mortgage in America and you get a whole load of subprime mortgages defaulting, or whether it's the Greek government or the Irish government or the Italian government, or a big company like LTCM that nearly collapsed the world markets in 98. Yeah. A big default can suddenly change all the perceptions of what that growth really meant. There's a shift in the frame. And that can suddenly start reversing the trend. What you'll find is that all the same mechanisms that allowed the bubble to grow now go into reverse and the bubble collapses very, very quickly. As people try and bail out of the markets, you know, then there's far fewer buyers. People won't buy, so you've got to keep lowering the price. And remember, trading just that one set of oil futures changed the price for all the oil stocks. So as people drive those prices down, as people try and offload their assets, they're driving prices down across the entire financial system. And the way that portfolios are interlinked, you know, the people who own assets right around the globe who are forced to sell, A lot of banks, for example, can't hold assets below BBB value. You know, anything below BBB rating is too risky. They've got to sell it. So if you get government bonds that go from BBB to BB, all of a sudden everyone in the banking sector is trying to sell, you know, hundreds of billions, maybe trillions worth of bonds into a market where nobody wants to buy. And the whole thing shrinks up. You know, and that's what's happened. And it's all to do with credit. Well, what's credit? Well, it's money. It's issuing money as debt. Well, who does that? Well, the banks. And we're back to money again. So here's the nub of the issue, I think, and this is the argument I'd leave you with. That if we're concerned, if we're the 99% and we're concerned what the 1% is doing, understand the nature of what that 1% does. It's to do with the money supply. We've allowed the private banking interest to control the creation of money. That's what we've got to reclaim here. Now, is that going to happen overnight? No. You know, is it possible to re-nationalise the banking system? Well, Jim Anderton did something very clever a few years ago. He set up Kiwi Bank. Okay, it's still a bank, it's still capitalist, but hey, when that makes money, it's a state asset. It makes money for the people. You know, it's something that we own as a community at the end of the day. There are ways in which you can set up small schemes for money. Now, these are a bit tricky. You know, you take the microcredit schemes that you get in local communities tend to be great if you want to exchange lawn mowing for aromatherapy. But you don't get too many lawyers and dentists who are willing to give you free treatment in return for that. But the principle is there. Reclaiming the money supply, I think, is the solution to the global crisis. And there are different ways to do that. I'm not going to talk about that today. So I'll leave it there. Any questions?